All right, what's going on, guys? This is Rob, and we are picking up with something besides the X-Men. I feel like it's been a while since we covered anything else in Marvel Comics, right? We've done Immortal Hulk, we've done the X-Men, and I feel like that's largely been it. So what I want to do here is I want to cover Iron Man, because we essentially have the return of what is one of the most powerful cosmic entities in existence, kind of, but not really. You guys will see what I'm talking about, right? It's actually one of the coolest things ever, and I'm curious to see if you guys can figure it out before I tell you who it is. So this largely comes or really kind of picks up with a bit of a conflict between Iron Man and Terrax. Now, Terrax, as a lot of you guys know, is a long-standing villain in the history of Marvel Comics. He was at one point a Herald of Galactus. These days, he's small time, right? You don't really see him being that big of a deal anymore. And even then, when you saw him in Hickman's Avengers, the new Avengers run, he was really more of just a plot device, just kind of there for the sake of telling a story and so on and so forth. And that's largely been his role in Marvel Comics, really since the 80s. But Terrax has taken out quite readily. But one of the things that we end up learning here is that Tony Stark has left his own company, Stark Unlimited. Now, this is business as usual. We've seen this happen multiple times over the course of Marvel Comics, but the way that Christopher Cantwell's doing this is really, really cool, right? Christopher Cantwell is a guy who's currently writing Iron Man. I was a little on the fence when I heard he was taking it over. I do not regret reading it. His writing is amazing. He's really, really cool with this. But one of the things that happens is he ends up getting a kind of $65 billion severance package, which is nice. And then from there, like in his fight with Terrax, he ends up like destroying a satellite, right? And then of course he gets a whole bunch of flack and a whole bunch of heat on social media. Now, one of the things that any YouTuber will tell you or social media influencer will tell you is take what people say on social media with a grain of salt. Social media is an answer to the question, what happens when people can say what they want without consequences? And social media will basically show you what people are really like, right? So it's kind of interesting. At the end of the day, Tony Stark seems to kind of get caught up in social media to a degree. But one of the things that he's also kind of criticized for and grilled for a little bit is the idea of him changing his career. When he's like, you know what? I'm stepping away from technology completely. Machines should be building machines. We need to get back in touch with what it means to be human. And she's like, when you say get back in touch with your roots, are you talking about the $65 billion exit package from Stark Unlimited, a $14.8 million Malibu mansion, and a computerized Iron Man suit? That's as dangerous as a thermonuclear weapon. Is that getting back to your roots? Is that what you're referring to? Because if you're talking about becoming an average man, they don't have any of that. So it's kind of a funny little thing there, but social media largely seems to have it out for him, right? You know, it's kind of taking it to him, but you kind of get these little tidbits here and there. He kind of packs everything up, right? He's kind of telling Rhodey, like, pack everything up, right? He's got his 1970 Boss 429 Mustang, which I always thought was kind of cool, but I'm more of a 1971 Chevelle 450 big block man myself. It's my dream car. But it's kind of this thing where Tony Stark's sort of just walking away from it all, right? Just literally leaving it all behind. And it's just like, I want to get back to a simpler life. And that kind of makes sense. Right? I mean, it is very difficult to look at a person who's a billionaire and see that, like, you know, man, life must be a struggle for them. But it's one of these things where a person's struggles aren't necessarily based on money. Oftentimes, they're just based on their life experiences, right? The things they go through. And if you're somebody like Iron Man, you've never had a moment's peace and you're kind of cursed with the gift of knowledge to a degree, but you're always out there doing something, right? You're always putting your life on the line. There's all these kind of threats that go on time and time again. It makes sense that there comes a point when you're like, you know what? I just want to be done with it all, right? Just buy some brownstone and just live some measure of a peaceful life. And so Tony Stark kind of starts to get a little bit reckless, or what you would expect a guy like him to do if he's just sort of getting out there and just doing things that he always thought would be fascinating. Like, for example, getting involved in a street race. Now, as you guys know from watching Fast and the Furious, nothing in this world is stronger than family. Not even Galactus. Family can beat Galactus. Family can beat cosmic entities. Thanos would have been defeated with the Infinity Stones and the Infinity Gauntlet had family stepped in. But Tony Stark kind of getting involved in these street races and so on, he's just kind of being reckless. I mean, to a degree, like, he puts like $5,000 on the line just to get involved in a race with this guy. But while all this is happening, small little things are taking place, right? Small little moments are going on behind the scenes, robberies, break-ins. And normally Tony Stark would never really concern himself with this, but then we get the appearance of a relatively interesting character, right? He kind of tweets out that he's holding a get together with some old friends, and he ends up being met with the arrival of Patsy Walker, Hellcat. Now, Patsy Walker was a huge deal back in the day, right? Like, back in the 70s and 80s, she was a huge deal, and she's really been around for a long, long time in Marvel. But the reality is she's just kind of been small peanuts for a long time. And that's one of the things that I want you guys to notice with what Christopher Cantwell's doing here is a lot of these old school small time guys, he's bringing them back, right? He's bringing back a lot of these old school small time characters. And it's kind of interesting because the relationship between Patsy Walker and Iron Man is such that they had a kind of romantic interest at one point, a bit of a fling, but there's history there. But in the middle of them talking and having this conversation, suddenly he's met by the arrival of a guy named Fuller Teilhard, I think is how you pronounce it. That's how I pronounce it. Or Teilhard, whatever. This guy basically has this business proposition. Now, this is almost kind of a shot for shot of Iron Man 3. When you had Killian, who approached Tony Stark with like, I have this really cool idea. You guys remember that whole scene from Iron Man 3? I know you guys try to block the movie out of your head, but this is kind of a shot for shot moment of that. When he basically pitches this idea to him, they could really change everything, right? Capturing lightning. And the whole idea behind that is lightning is an exceedingly powerful source of energy and it's naturally occurring. So why not harness that and then basically use like waste-free energy that can power the world, right? That can do all kinds of things to fix the world. Now, the reality is Tony Stark isn't necessarily against this because he's like, I mean, there's no real profit to be made here or I can't weaponize it or anything like that. It's largely because one, he's wearing fuzzy bunny slippers and two, he just doesn't really care about that kind of stuff anymore. It doesn't really seem to be relevant to him anymore. And so he's like, I mean, lightning's cool, you know, that's whatever. And then just kind of walks away with Patsy Walker. You know, this guy's kind of like, well, I mean, you know, if you ever decide to change your mind, let me know. That will be incredibly important. And the reason why is because Iron Man getting back to his roots is not necessarily him walking away from the role of Iron Man. And in fact, he actually breaks out a vintage suit from back in the day when he was simply just the Golden Avenger, right? An old school Iron Man suit. That in the eyes of Tony Stark, there's almost a kind of level of humanity that's lost with the advent of technology. And there's really no one better to make that case than him, right? The average person on Twitter is not equipped to make that case. A futurist, a person who's developed some of the most advanced technologies in the world, and in fact, the foremost authority on technology is equipped to make that argument because he understands the full breadth of what technology has done for and to society and what it will lead to. That's one of the things to keep in mind. Iron Man's always been a futurist, right? Tony Stark has always looked to the future. He builds for tomorrow. He doesn't build for today. And that's why technologically, even comparing him to people like Reed Richards or like Wakanda or something like that, he's usually always a step ahead of them. It's one of the things that was established during and at the end of Jonathan Hickman's Avengers and New Avengers run is that in comparison to everybody else out there, T'Challa, Reed Richards, all these guys, even Peter Parker to a degree, or even Dr. Octopus, Iron Man's ahead of all of them, right? Just in terms of his ability to develop technologies. The only thing that limits him is the technology around him, right? What he can build based on the existing resources that he has. But if he were to go to Wakanda and he had all the resources in Wakanda, it would dwarf everything that Wakanda's built already. I mean, Wakanda never really had the ability to build a Dyson sphere. Tony Stark did, right? To literally build one around the sun. It was one of the most monumental achievements and he had to use alien technology in order to pull it off. It's one of these things where he kind of sits down and he has this bit of a conversation with Patsy Walker and he starts out kind of having this bit of an existential crisis. I don't really know who I am anymore. When she asks the question, like, what's the whole point behind this, right? What's the whole idea behind leaving technology behind, walking away from Stark Unlimited and then living more of a peaceful life and just kind of going back to the days when it was just you and Iron Man and that was basically it. What's the point behind all this, right? Why are you even hanging out with me? Like, we haven't hung out in forever. And the response of Tony is, I don't know who I am anymore, right? I don't really know what my deal is anymore. I don't know my purpose in all of this, right? An existential crisis on behalf of Tony Stark. And that's when, in the middle of all this, they suddenly realize that Unicorn is launching a heist. Now, you're probably asking your question, who's Unicorn? And rightfully so. Unicorn hasn't been relevant in decades. And when I say decades, I mean decades. But Unicorn is a guy with super strength, right? He can lift something like 15 tons, if my memory serves me correctly. He's pretty powerful, right? He's a strong character. But he is, if there was something lower than a Z-list villain, it would be him. But the crazy thing is, the whole time he's doing this, he keeps referencing a guy called The Other, right? And he's literally stolen this book from a library of all places, right? And it's like, why would this guy break into a library and steal a book? But the other thing is there's a few kind of enhancements here, enough that he's able to really hold his own against Iron Man, kind of subdue him for a second, and then ultimately escape, but not before Iron Man basically, you know, knocks down the helicopter, sends a crash into the ground, and then basically, you know, Unicorn is arrested, and Iron Man realizes what he's stolen here is the Gutenberg Bible. Now, this is the weirdest thing to steal, because the significance of the Gutenberg Bible is it was the first book that was printed with the Gutenberg Press, which started the process of just mass-producing books using machinery. But the fact that this is being stolen by some guy like Unicorn, it doesn't make any sense, right? It's like, why would you do this? And who's the other, right? Who's this being that you're referring to? And so what you end up doing is you actually switch over to this guy that Iron Man had been talking to previously, and this guy's just kind of standing in a window staring out. Now, if you look at this bottom panel here, anybody who knows anything about the history of Marvel Comics will be able to tell you right off the bat who this guy is, right? If you ever read the history of Marvel, I mean, the artwork tells tells you who this guy is. But for those of you guys who are unsure, and those of you guys who have not been able to guess it yet, you pick up 1 year prior to all of this. And basically this system is kind of brought online, right? This being is basically brought online by the Enclave. Now, those of you guys who don't really know what the Enclave is, they are significant, right? They're hugely significant. The Enclave were the ones who basically developed Adam Warlock. The idea behind the Enclave is basically they're a collection of scientists who want to run the world, right? Who want to like conquer the world, focusing on like science and technology, as opposed to having some kind of nefarious purpose, right? They're not really looking to be like, you know, dictators that rule the world with an iron fist. They just kind of believe that humanity is its problem, and that forcing humanity to exist on a more scientific and technological level would basically make the world better. The other part of this is that this guy's referred to as Adam 4, again, kind of picking up from the Adam Warlock project, that Adam Warlock would be referred to as Adam 1, and they've had various attempts over the years to duplicate Adam Warlock, right? Kismet is a perfect example of that. But this guy says, do not call me Adam, call me by my real name, Korvac. So this is kind of a crazy thing. The return of Michael Korvac. And they ask, like, what's your mission? And it's like, you know, something about saving the Enclave, I don't know, but your mission is selfish, right? Like, and this is one of the coolest things he says here. He says, what makes humans so arrogant as to think their world is more important than any other? Why make the world a better place? Why not make the universe a better place, a better reality for everybody who's here? And this guy responds and says, you're a cybernetic amalgamation, you're superior. Opinions on these matters are beneath you. It's your nearly unlimited intellect that is required. And before he can finish, he says, it's my nearly unlimited intellect that tells me this universe is a landfill that is conflict laden and war torn by the greedy. It tells me that this is a reality that, while filled with those proclaiming to be gods, is ultimately godless and lost. And ultimately, it tells me that I am but mere steps away from becoming the god that it needs. You can have your Enclave. I have bigger plans, and I must begin immediately. Now, this is the bane of the existence when it comes to the Enclave. When they originally made Adam Warlock, they had to fly in Alicia Masters, right? The blind girlfriend of Ben Grimm, because the light emitting from Adam Warlock was too bright for them to see, and they had to know if their experiment was a success. But almost immediately after Adam Warlock emerged, he turned against the Enclave, fought alongside the Fantastic Four, and then bolted. And then he kidnapped Sif and tried to marry her, which is kind of weird. But it's the bane of the existence of the Enclave that every organism that they either manufacture or alter ends up turning against them. Because honestly, despite the fact that they exist based on the beliefs of science and technology, they defy logic and reason in terms of their motivation and why they want to do what they do. And so switching back over to Iron Man, suddenly he's basically caught up in Murder World, right? Now, we don't really know exactly how he got here. And even Iron Man says, I don't know how I'm here. It's just him and Crusher Creel that were snatched up and brought to this place. And Crusher Creel's like, look, if I have to destroy you in order to get out of here, then that's exactly what I'll do. Iron Man ends up figuring out that it was basically Arcade. And then, of course, once he unmasks Arcade, they end up freeing themselves and so on. But this is going towards the kind of continued crushing of Iron Man as far as public opinion goes. That Iron Man is doing things that the general public doesn't like. And so the general public is turning against him. Whether it's logical or reasonable is irrelevant, right? That it doesn't really matter whether or not what people believe is logical and reasonable. It's just what they believe. And people will steadfast their beliefs and very rarely ever change them unless they absolutely have to. And it's only really in the face of conflict or destruction that they have to change their opinions. But you end up having this kind of situation over and over and over again. This is what's happening. Time and time again, there's these different villains that are showing up here, right? One guy kidnaps a whole bunch of guys from Stark Unlimited, and Tony Stark has to go in and save them. You know, it's just this kind of situation, this kind of process that repeats itself continually, that you end up having Iron Man who basically kind of saves the day, albeit, you know, with a few dangers here and there. He breaks his bones, right? He has like 17 fractures. You know, he's like, his left lung is punctured and so on and so forth. But like, kind of enduring these struggles over and over and over again, it's just kind of the nature of the current situation that Iron Man is in. Because at the end of the day, Korvac has some kind of plan under his belt, and all these guys that are being brought in is being done for the purpose of serving this plan. Now the question is why? Because the next thing you see is Iron Man who faces off against the Melter, and the Melter just like melts his car. And it's a weird thing, right? It's almost like these guys are kind of playing games with him, screwing up his head, you know, just kind of appearing out of nowhere. It's just kind of small time stuff. You would normally never see Iron Man engage in a conflict like this with these small time guys, but for some reason or another, they're all being brought together by Korvac for the purpose of facing off against Iron Man. Unlike Michael Korvac in, you know, as he originally appeared, in the sense that he was just basically a lazy guy, right, existing in a future that was ruled by the Badoon. Instead, like, he's more or less been kind of either recreated, manufactured, whatever, and is just kind of going off his own schemes that make sense to himself, and just basically seeking godhood. And that's what he tells Tony Stark, that ultimately we find out that Tony Stark backed the experiment of this guy, not knowing it was Korvac. And in doing that, that this entire process plays out the way this guy intended it to, where essentially he kind of invites Iron Man here. Iron Man's like, okay, I want to see what my investment bought me. And then as soon as that goes on, he's immediately hit by lightning, right? Taken out by this, by Korvac. And then Korvac brings together the other guys that have more or less been freed, right? Unicorn's been freed, the controller's here, right? It's just kind of this thing over and over where they're like, we're going to take you out, right? I got these three guys because they seem to be the most equipped in taking you on. Now, this again is another kind of reflection of the old school Korvac stories, because the reality is these guys are not a challenge for Iron Man, and they never really were. Iron Man was able to overcome them pretty readily. I mean, guys like the controller are kind of powerful, but they're all B or C list villains. And so it really seems more of an indication that Korvac is kind of learning as he goes along. And that was the nature of the original Korvac. Once he stole the power of Galactus and was almost really more machine than man, even in the events leading up to that, he was kind of figuring things out as he was doing them. And that's why the Korvac saga is so cool, because you see this guy who's basically lazy, who's turned into a machine, who steals the power of Galactus, who comes back to the modern day, and then basically just kind of becomes more and more of a credible threat as the story goes on, all the way up until the point where he reaches godhood. And that's what this guy's trying to do. That's why him and Korvac are really linked in this way, as he's just kind of like seemingly a remade version or returned version of Korvac, because he says, I'm not looking to achieve demigod level status. I'll do that here in a moment, right? I'll achieve this kind of demigod level of power where I'm at right now, but I'm looking to attain full on godhood. That's his mission. That's his goal, because that's what the original Michael Korvac did. So with that being said, guys, we're going to bring this to an end. Let me know what you guys think down in the comment section. I love what's going on with Iron Man right now. And I will catch you all later. Peace.